Welcome, this is Literary Goa. We have with us today Valmiki Falero, the author of two books and many more in the pipeline, both related, one to Margaon and one to Goa in general. Valmiki, maybe we'll start with Soaring Spirit. And could you tell us a bit about how the book came about?
Frederick, basically whatever work I have done is concerning things that have not been done before. So happens that this Holy Spirit Church in Margaon, which is the second oldest church in Salsette, was going to celebrate its 450th anniversary. It had already seen four centenaries passed. Yet there was not even a souvenir that had been brought out before on any of the previous four occasions. So when I realized that, I said, why not put something together? Because I have been working on a larger subject, that's the whole of Margaon, starting from practically prehistoric times, or rather, let's say, before the advent of Indo-Aryans in Goa, down to the present. So I had to try and cover this very historic monument, that's the Holy Spirit Church in Margaon. It's the second oldest church in Salsette after Rashol. And there was nothing available on at one place in one language. So that's how the idea for the book came.
Of course, the book looks at the history of the church itself and the parish priest in the church and, you know, many different historical aspects about the church, including that strange experience during the spring equinox where the light falls exactly on the altars and things like that. But there is also a huge element about the area around the church and the inhabitants of that area, describing the streets, describing the people, describing the geography, which is a very you know, strong local history of the place, right?
Yeah, I have devoted a kind of a chapter on that Largo de Iglesia, as they call it, the church square. Trying to retrace wherever possible the history of all the houses which existed at one point of time and exist till today. But of course the book starts with a stage which goes much earlier. It starts with how Christianity dawned in Salsette, then spread to Margaon, and then how the church came about. This is of course the fifth edition of the church, of the edifice. But right from the beginning kind of thing.
So the church kept on being rebuilt and, you know.
Yeah, the church was, you see, the first edition was burnt down by the invading Muslims. If you know, right up till 1580 or so, the Portuguese and the Bijapur kingdom of Adil Shah, you know, were at loggerheads. And Salsette and your home taluka of Bardes, both were, you know, caught up in the middle of this strife.
They were not yet fixed in whose area they were. They kept changing hands again and again.
Precisely. It was practically a seesaw battle between them.
Yeah.
For a year or two, Salsette and Bardes were with the Portuguese. The next two or three years were they were with the Muslims and so on it went. Until 1543, when both Salsette and Bardes came under the definitive possession of the Portuguese. And it was only around 1560 or so that you see, the Jesuits who were assigned the taluka of Salsette for spreading Christianity took up their mission.
So in that sense, you know, the book, I mean, can you give us an introduction to its contents, what it carries, what it focuses on?
Yeah.
I particularly like the you know, the blurb at the end where you if you could just explain this part, the first part of it, and tell us, you know,
okay,
what's the mystery there?
Now, the first church in South Goa was built not in Verna. Now, because Verna happens to be the site of the first
mass
that was celebrated on the soil of Salsette.
Yeah.
This was during one of the seesaw battles between the Muslims and the Portuguese. When Verna was taken over by a Portuguese garrison, and the chaplain of the garrison celebrated mass.
There's still a small
stone, cross.
Yeah, marking the site.
And this happened in 1519. So one would expect that, okay, in pursuance of that, you see that the first church in Salcedo would have come. It was not. Nor was it in Korthali. Now, Korthali is a very historic place as far as Christianity, the history of Christianity in Salcedo goes. There were Christians from Salcedo who were converted in the capital city, which is today old Goa.
I see.
From various places in various villages in Salcedo. There is a record of there being Christians in Carmona, for example. There is a record of there being Christians, you know, from different villages in Salcedo, but who were converted in the course of their occupation or trade, whatever, you know, they were doing in the capital city. But it was on the soil of, I mean, that it was a native of Korthali who was the first to be converted. On the soil of Salcedo.
I see.
So in that sense, Korthali is a very historic place. That's where the first two Jesuit missionaries, one was an ordained priest and the second was a Jesuit brother, Manuel Gomes. Father Pedro and Brother Manuel were the first to cross the Zuari River into Korthali, where they erected a small cross and celebrated Mass. And eventually, a day or two later, they got their first catch.
This is in which year?
The year when they were here, 1561, second, I think it was in around 1563.
Okay.
1563. Okay. When they came here.
I see.
Now that itself again is a very interesting story. You see, they were given Salcedo decades before.
Yeah.
But the Jesuits did not have enough of personnel here.
Okay. From the 1540s when they first came, 1542 probably.
1542, since Francis Xavier landed in Goa. Thereafterwards, the three talukas, Goa at that time comprised of Bardia, Salcedo and Ilias, Tiswadi. Parts of Tiswadi were bifurcated amongst the Jesuits, the Dominicans.
Half and half, east
kind
and
of,
west.
Franciscans were given Bardias, of course, and the Jesuits were given some islands in the Tiswadi, that is Divar, Chorao, Santishtevo, and a few other places, and Salcedo. But they were so concentrated on Chorao, particularly on Chorao and Divar. You see, that again had some caste connotations, but let's not get into that. That they didn't have enough of people to spare for Salcedo. Finally, it was at the instance of the local archbishop, the local governor, and everyone had to intervene and ask the Jesuit superior present at that time to spare at least one or two people to take care of the Christians who had already converted in the city, but had nobody to administer the sacraments to. And there was a fear that they would relapse back.
Right.
So the thing is, of course, the first church in South Goa, as one would expect, was not in Verna, nor was it in Korthali, but it was in Rashol.
Yeah.
It came in the form of a garrison chapel. When Rashol, you see, for the first time, now we are not sure which year precisely this particular Rashol church was constructed. Initially, it was in 1520 or 1519 or 21, when Vijayanagar kingdom took over, you see, the lands from Bijapur and ceded them to the Portuguese. So the Portuguese governor at that particular point of time was not present in Goa. So the Goa captain, the military captain, he took over Rashol, the garrison, and the garrison town rather, and placed a small military force over there. Now, every Portuguese garrison used to be accompanied by a military chaplain. So it's quite possible that the first chapel was constructed in Rashol around that time, in 1519, 1521. But there is no documentary proof of that.
I see.
Then we know, of course, from 1543, when Salcedo came under the definitive possession of the Portuguese, that the church in Rashol, at that time a chapel, of course, was constructed in Rashol.
History is very interesting, and would it be right to conclude that your favorite subject in school was history?
Not really. My favorite subject in school, thanks to a Jesuit brother called Brother Joseph,
was maths.
Was chemistry.
Chemistry. Brother Joseph, who was in Brito's also later.
He was later in Brito's.
Chemistry.
He's
man of very few words and
very few words, but excellent.
Soft-spoken.
Yeah, excellent in his methodology of imparting knowledge in a very very systematic, interesting way.
Okay, so you know, without going away from the topic of your books, I just want to focus on one or two things. One is that you have been a man of many roles. Like, you were in journalism, you were in politics for a while as the chairperson of the Margao municipality, which I know you want to forget. You were in entrepreneurship and building for a while. But more than that, you know, I mean, the large number of bylines that you got in journalism, and of course your background is commerce in that sense, you know. With all these different strands coming in, how and why did you get so deeply interested in A, history, B, Konkani? We'll talk about Konkani later, because I know that's a story in itself, how you met Olivino Gomes in Delhi and things like that. But history, how did you get involved with, and why this fascination for a field which is quite complex and difficult to understand also? And most of us, unlike, say, our former colonial rulers, we don't have a strong sense of history like the Portuguese do. Correct me if I'm wrong.
I wouldn't exactly concur, but the, by and large, what the grain of what you say is true. But there are people, like, for example, in my own, I was fortunate enough to be born into a household where people were interested in the past.
There are. It's a small group. They are deeply interested, but not by and large, it's not like, you know, prevalent.
Yes, by and large, I would agree with you.
So how did you get interested in the field?
Essentially, I had an aunt at home, a paternal aunt, my father's sister, who was not married, and who would relate many a story from the past.
I see.
Like, for example, at that particular point of time, she had mentioned about the Maratha attack. Today, I know it was an attack by Sambhaji, because there were so many Maratha attacks on Salset. It was the attack by Sambhaji in 1583, which was the most vicious on Goa ever.
I see.
There was never an attack which was that merciless. And villages right from Kunkolim, which was, you know, the first place to be attacked by any adversary, right down to Margao, and they even marched up to Rashol, but they could not kind of overcome that resistance there, because Rashol was very well defended by more than two or three dozen cannons at that time.
I see.
Guns of different calibers. But you see, that was a story that had stuck in the, apparently, in the local psyche. And very often she told me things like that. I mean, this was just one example, an instance that I gave you. That slowly, I think, must have...
You wrote something about how it affects the architecture of local Margao houses and houses being connected, or stories of tunnels leading
exactly
to Rashol.
The old, you know, habitation zone of Margao. In fact, the people of Margao, they are nicknamed rats.
Undir, you know? Undir.
Undir. Rats live in small little holes and all, you know. They are all kind of... So also for the houses in Margao, they were compartmentalized and all touching with common walls.
I see.
And possibly in view of this such attacks, we don't know from when, I don't know the vintage of the thing, but I do know that all the houses right from Old Market, going up to a Santush house, which is today church property, it's named after the late Pope. Marriage counseling, marriage preparation courses and all that are being held there. In the courtyard of the house, there was opening of a tunnel.
I see.
Which I have seen in my
younger days.
And all the houses, you see, it was a kind of a escape route for people, for women and children. And that tunnel led through Borda and opened in Rashol.
My goodness.
Now, at the other end, there are documented stories of a priest, for example, somewhere in the 1930s, who went down with his dog to see where the tunnel would lead to. The dog returned, but the priest did not.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, they kept food and a lamp and all that for a number of days in the hope that he would come back, but he didn't.
I see.
Yeah.
Interesting. What else is there in this book? I mean, it's a very intense work of local history. Everything dealing with everyone in the place, the families, the homes, and sometimes people say that it's too much of navel gazing, but I think that for someone who's connected with the place, it makes a lot of sense to have a history of their own. No?
See, basically there are a number of Margao, let's not forget, it's been called the commercial capital of Goa.
Also the Athens of Goa, no?
The Athens of Goa is called during the Portuguese time.
Center of culture.
Center of culture. It was not just the center of culture. It was the center of, you see, Goan, Indo-Aryan existence. The first Indo-Aryans who came, they came to Salcete.
Mattagram.
And Mattagram was the principal village of the place. And it was from Salcete that these 96, what we call Chennai today, which is today used as a kind of a prefix to the surname.
Chennai.
Chennai. Chennai, Sinai in Portuguese, Chennai in Konkani.
Yeah.
They all denote the number 96, which in turn denotes the 96 original Indo-Aryan families that first came in the first wave. So, Margao always had a place of very great importance in that sense. Now, some of the principal temples, some of the principal religious schools, which are called mathas,
yeah,
you see, were situated in Margao. Margao had a total of 14 temples and many more number of schools put together. Margao was not just the geographical area of Margao today. You see, it included the entire of the Naveli village.
I see.
It included the present village of Nuve.
That's right.
Now, Nuve and Naveli, they had no separate gaonkaris of their own because they were wards of Margao.
I see.
Yes. So, the place was kind of leading. It's only the people from Verna who always had a kind of a tussle, you know, for supremacy with
rivalry,
people from
Margao,
rivalry. But Margao was, by and large, you see, being the capital village of the taluka, which was Goa's largest taluka, in terms of population, in terms of area, in terms of revenue yield, Salcete was the leading capital. And it was from Salcete that the Indo-Aryans then migrated to Tiswadi and later on to Bardes.
I see. Very interesting.
So the history of the place is, should normally, in normal terms, easy interest the people who are interested in the history of the entire of the whole of Goa.
Moving on from this book to the second book, it's a very different book, Patriotism in Action, Goans in India's Defense Services. Okay, so why, how, when? I know it's a bit contentious and
how, you see, my father happened to be a doctor in the then Indian Army Medical Corps. Today it's known as the Army Medical Corps. And he always wanted me to join the Indian Army.
I see.
He had even selected the branch for me. He wanted me to be in the infantry.
I see.
No guns and, no mechanized division or any other branch of the army for me. He wanted me to. And he had told me that, you know, that he would like to see me pass out.
Yeah.
You know, from the portals of the IMA, the Indian Military Academy at Dehradun, where of course he had also undergone his training before he joined the army. That was during the British days, during the Second World War. But he continued much after 47. And I couldn't live up to that dream. I lost him exactly one day before my SSA exams.
Oh gosh.
So that must have been, you see, at the back of my mind, some kind of a subconscious thing that, look, you were not able to do that, at least do something else. Then somewhere around 76, 77, as you know, there was a kind of a tiff between the local archbishop and the then chief minister of Goa. The chief minister withdrew the archbishop's ferry crossing priority.
Priority, which was a big issue in those days because everyone had to cross a ferry to reach Salcete, no?
Exactly.
To reach Margao.
Not only at all ferry
points. At all ferry points, including Bethi.
Including Bethi.
We didn't have a bridge.
Then, for example, from Pumurpa to Aldana and wherever, Shorang, Piyadadivar, and all the places. But more than that, you see, what they said is the party that was, you see, to which the chief
ruling party at that time.
Made kind of official statements to the effect that Goan Christians, Catholics, were anti-national and deserved to be deported to Portugal.
I see.
Now, this was not true, and that I knew. I also knew that there were a number of Goans who were serving in the officer ranks of the three wings of the services, India Defense Services, but we didn't have a number.
Right.
There again, there was no published data.
Total shortage of information.
Complete, absolute blank. We knew that, okay, there was X
some
or
names,
there was Y.
Some names, X, Y, Z, yeah. Some few friends or family or relations. Or
some very, you know, people who rose to the top and all that. Those names, they were known. But that there were such large number of Goans in the Defense Services of India was a fact that was not known.
So in your book, you come out with how many officer rank people?
Approximately, this was done in a big hurry, but approximately about 400.
And today you have more?
I have almost twice the number.
Twice the number?
And my gut feeling is that the actual number should be at least four times.
Oh, wow.
There should be at least around 1,500 to 2,000 officer ranks in the three services of India on either side of 1947.
And of these, most would be Catholic or what?
Statistically speaking, as we come across over here, and even in my larger database, around 90% of the officers who serve the nation, defending the borders, were Goan Catholics.
But then, Valmiki, it begs the question that today that trend is not continuing, no? It doesn't seem to be, or we don't know, or what is it?
That is not affecting only one community. It's across the board.
I see.
You might be aware that, you see, the government of India now has, made things far simpler, trying to attract talent, particularly technical talent, for example, in the Navy, where, everything is being modernized and you require more brains than brawn, and trying to attract, you see, the right kind of people to the forces. That's not specific. The point that you made is not relevant only to Goa. It's across the nation.
So in that sense, how did you dig out these names? How did you find them? It's a tough job, no? One by one, you have to go and catch them.
Unfortunately, it all started with Wing Commander Abrio, who died in Hashimara. His body was to be brought to Goa. He was a Don Bosco boy from Chorong, or a native.
He was a pilot of?
He was flying MiGs. He was okay. He actually died flying, a MiG-29.
Which year?
This would be around 2009. Late 2009. Or maybe early 2010.
I see.
Now, there were so many other Goan pilots, who had died with the boots on in the course of duty.
I see.
And the local print media, with due apologies to you.
No, you don't.
Did not cover this event the way it ought to have been covered. There should have been a carryover story, which said that, these were the others also who died. There was Wing Commander Clarence De Lima from Sukkur. He was the commander of a flight comprising of five crew members, cockpit members, plus cabin staff, flying the then Prime Minister of India to Jorhat and to some place in the northeast.
Morarji Desai.
His brother Kantibai Desai. Also on board was the then chief of the Prime Minister Security, John Lobo, brother of Bishop Ignatius Lobo.
Yeah.
He, in fact, lifted Kantibai, who had fractured his leg in the crash landing, and took him to safety. Now, this man, Wing Commander Clarence, he took a decision to nose land instead of a normal belly landing, because his landing gear was damaged.
I see.
That was, a kind of a, practically you could say, like a wartime sacrifice that you make for your nation.
I see.
Then there were so many others.
He died himself?
All the five perished.
Died?
All the five died. Only the two who were in the cabin were saved. The two Indian Air Force people who were in the cabin. Non-flying members. Non-crew members, let's say. They were the people who trudged back to Jorhat Air Base and informed them so and so thing. And the Prime Minister of India was lying under a tree in some God-forbidden paddy field.
I see. No, my goodness.
Around 5 kilometers from Jorhat. So there were so many others who perished in the sense, they practically made the supreme sacrifice in the 1971 operations. both on the eastern sector, that's Bangladesh, and the western sector, Pakistan. There was absolutely nobody remembered them at this particular point of time.
This small community playing such a big role in history, it's quite amazing. Not only, of course, in the armed forces, but also outside. No? That's quite, if you look at online sources like Eddie Fernandez's goanvoice.org.uk and all that, you find these unknown people who are playing this big role. Of course, it's a huge job to dig out all these names and to put them all together, 400, and you're saying you have much more work to do. But tell us about the work which is pending and the books and plans which are pending. We have a little while to...
Just only before that, yeah. One small little thing. You see, when I met the former chief of the army staff and I told him about this idea, he says, excellent, but how are you going to get the...
Information.
The information. I said, from your archives. He says, our archives in the army, the Air Force might have centralized archives, the Navy might have, they have much smaller
operations.
Here they are spread across the regimental, every regimental center. Then of course there were practical difficulties. Like let's say a surname of Fernandez. Now, how do you know that he's a Tamilian or a Keralite? There are Keralite Fernandezes.
Yeah, one of Mangalorean the best or Bengali.
Ophthalmologists. Yeah.
I see.
Mangaloreans, there could be East Indian, he could be an Anglo-Indian.
Correct.
Anybody. How do you know that he's a Goan? But then that's precisely the thing, the smallness of the Goan community, you know, that helped me network and get all the names. Other pending books, of course...
I know again, there are many.
No, but again on things which have never been done before. Say one. That is a book on the monuments of old Goa. You would say, there are already dozens of books on old Goa. True. But mine will be a little bit different.
Different.
It's not going to be something that the visitor... You see, can see visually when he's there visiting the monument. It will be the story that lies
behind it,
behind the monument. You see the legends, the stories, and you know all the things. For example, why there is no cross on the dome of Saint Cajetan's Church in Old Goa?
Don't spoil the secret, but tell us about Konkani Sings.
Konkani Proverbs, Frederick, you know, you are aware of the whole thing. Question is, you see, the whole idea is to. In a nutshell, to project what Goan life was generally.
Through sayings.
Through the sayings. It's not just the idiom, it's a way of living. I mean the Goan way of life, which we have, you see, in our modern age practically lost.
History of Margaon, bigger book?
Yes, from Mattagram to Margaon, that will be the last, hopefully, inshallah.
No, don't make it the last. You have many stories to tell.
There are more books that I'm also working on.
Like?
There is one on the not exactly the history of the Konkani language, but related to proverbs.
While on that point, tell us about how Olivinho Gomes influenced your interest in history.
Oh, my God.
I understood it.
I happened to meet Dr. Olivine in Bombay first. And he was the man who actually opened my eyes to the richness of this language. Like, for example, he said, and just this much will suffice, the sunrise, for example. Sunrise, in English, we have just one word, and that's sunrise.
Right.
In Konkani, practically every phase of the rising sun has a different word. Surya, Porasolta, Surya, Surya. You know, practically every stage until the sun is up in the horizon. So that is the richness, and that I find, you see, when I'm trying to translate the Konkani adages or proverbs into English. English is very inadequate because here the nuances and the, you know, extremely rich.
Well, on this point, I must congratulate you on all the work you put in. Hope that you finish all the unfinished work, you know, soon. And also thank you for playing a role in getting me into this profession by sitting on the first interview which I sat for. So whatever good and bad comes out of it, you are partly to blame. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Frederick.
And that was Valmiki Phalero. Thank you.
Thank you very much.